Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be here. This is joint work with Dr. Owen Garrick, who is a physician in Oakland. And his wife, Dr. Jocelyn Garrick, is also a physician actually at Highland. And she's the founder of a mentoring in medicine and science nonprofit. And I'm very fortunate to have Asha, the director of that nonprofit, giving comments on this paper immediately following my presentation. So it might be a little bit shorter than the last one. So this is our general outline. I'll just talk about why we were interested in this question of doctor diversity, and then I'll discuss the design and the results. So as it probably comes as no surprise that, in fact, our physician workforce does not have population level representation of either Hispanics, African Americans, or Native Americans for that matter. The statistics have been pretty stagnant, particularly for African American men. So we've only had about 500 African American male medical students in an incoming class each year off of a base of 21,000, and that number has been unchanged since the 1970s. So as a percent of the incoming class of medical students, they only make up about 2.5%. Overall, we have about 7% of medical students are African American, and that number has grown over time, but that growth has come from African American women, not really from the men at all. Those numbers are all about flows. If we look at the stock of the physician workforce, only about 6% of the physician workforce is African American. And that's less than half of the population level representation of African Americans in the United States. So what's the arguments to kind of keep things as is? Well, as they have been stagnant, particularly for African American men. Well, if we think that we're doing a great job screening applicants through the MCATs and through GPAs, and we just want the best and the brightest to be physicians, then you know, then maybe this is the right equilibrium, 500 per year, 2.5%. But particularly when it comes to medicine, or really any consumer-facing industry, we might think that we should have some representation in the profession of the population they're trying to serve. And that's particularly relevant for healthcare in the United States, because a lot of the stark gradients that we see between life expectancies across groups and the very, very dismal outcomes that drive the inequality are among low-income minority populations. In fact, African American men have the lowest life expectancy of any major demographic group in the United States. But it's not just me who's making these arguments. If you look at major medical institutions from the AAMC, which is the Association of American Medical Colleges, or the AMA, the American Medical Association, or the National Academies of Medicine, all have statements about why it's important to have a more diverse physician workforce. In fact, it's recommendation number one from the AAMC about how we could reduce racial health disparities in the United States. But what we wanted to know is whether are these just normative recommendations, or is there an actual effect on demand for preventative care among low-income African American men from basically having the opportunity that many in this room already take for granted, which is to have a race and sex concordant physician see them when they go to seek care. So we developed an experimental design, which I'll walk you through. And it was really informed by actually our partners throughout the community, and particularly by working with Dr. Owen Garrick. So we recruited from barbershops in the East Bay area. And Dr. Owen Garrick mentioned that this was a great place to recruit because men were generally, it represented a broad cross-section of the African-American male population. Men were generally kind of hanging out, waiting, and so it was a good time to survey them. It was a trusted space, going back to Bilal's presentation. It was a trusted place for us to approach them. And as Dr. Garrick said, it didn't matter if you had hair or you didn't. Every 2 weeks, you would go to see your barber and hang out. So that ended up being the case. We were able to recruit approximately 1,300 men with the hard work and efforts of mostly minority college students who were looking to go into medicine, would obtain informed consent and approach these men. And they would fill out a short survey on their socio-demographic background, as well as their healthcare experience and healthcare challenges. And in exchange, we would give them a free haircut that day. So it worked out pretty well. Then we distributed a free coupon for a free men's health screening. Now, we focused on preventive care, because that's really the low-hanging fruit in terms of medicine. You know, if you can manage the blood pressure before a stroke, control the sugar before end-stage kidney disease, catch the cancer before it metastasizes, that's really, really where you can see these health gaps start to shrink. And so we incentivized them coming to the clinic, and we offered them free health screenings for diabetes, cholesterol, BMI, as well as blood pressure. Now you'll notice we also did provide flu shots, courtesy of Alameda County, who donated them, but we didn't advertise it on these coupons, and that's because of some in-depth focus group work that revealed that some of that could raise a lot of trepidation and maybe suppress even showing up at our clinic. Now, the clinic ran on Saturdays, and we hired 14 physicians, approximately half were African American male physicians and half were Caucasian and Asian, to staff our clinic. That wasn't the initial plan. The initial plan was to partner with a community health center, but we were very pressed to find a community health center that employed one, particularly more than one African-American male physician on staff at the same time, which led us to this alternative approach of basically running our own clinic. So going back to the flowchart here, approximately half of those 1,300 individuals that we recruited from the barbershops actually came to our clinic. Obviously, the $50 show-up incentive helped with those presentation rates. But another big help was from Uber, who donated ride-sharing services. So individuals that didn't have a license or a car could still take advantage of the free services. Now, there's two stages of outcomes that I want to focus your attention on. So at two points in the trial did subjects have to make a decision. One, in the pre-consultation stage, where they made selections as to what preventative service they wanted on a tablet, and one in a post-consultation stage. So let's look at the pre-consultation stage. So they received a tablet in the privacy of the patient room after they had been randomized to see either a black or white, or non-black rather, physician, and they were introduced to their doctor via this tablet. This is a good point in time to mention that the study was double blind. So neither the subjects nor the doctors knew that we were particularly studying race concordance. What they knew, what everyone knew, was that we were trying to improve the take-up of preventative care among low-income African-American men. So these photos were taken for identification purposes. The doctors didn't actually know that this tablet stage was occurring. So the tablets say that your assigned doctor for today is Dr. Blank, and on the next page you'll be asked to select services you wish to receive from Dr. Blank, and Dr. Blank will administer all these services that you choose. And then we have a blanket statement about the quality of the doctor. They were all actually really well trained. And then they get to make their selections here. And this was a randomized order of the list of selections, and none of the above was always an option, though very few chose that. Then the subject actually would visit with the doctor, and they would get an opportunity to revise their selections. Why did we have this sort of two-stage approach? Well, the first stage is a classic audit study. So if you thought that there was just a strong taste-based aversion to seeing, for example, doctors of a different race, we would expect to see differences right after that first stage. But if it's really something about the quality of the patient-doctor relationship, again, going back to Bilal's presentation, something about interpersonal trust, then we wouldn't expect to see differences until after they actually had that consultation. So what do we find? So the gray bars represent the mean demand for subjects that are randomized to a non-African-American doctor, and the blue bars are the demand for those that are randomized to an African-American doctor, and we have things broken out by pre-consultation and then post-consultation stage, and then the title here is of the service that's selected. So you can see in the pre-consultation stage for something like blood pressure, approximately 60% of subjects elect to receive blood pressure, and that really is not different across those that receive a concordant versus a race discordant physician. Similarly for BMI, really no differences in these pre-consultation stages. But in the post-consultation stage, even though the gray bars do shift up, indicating an increase in demand, we start to see a little bit of separation between those that receive a concordant versus a discordant doctor. Now, these are for non-invasive services, and these differences in the post-consultation stage just become even larger for invasive services, those services that require the subject to give blood or an injection. And it might be easier to see when we look at things not in levels, but in terms of percents. So here we're just plotting the post-consultation black versus white, concordant versus discordant percent change in the treatment effect by the services that were offered. So blood pressure, BMI, we're getting treatment effects in the 25 to 30% range. And then for the invasive things, we're getting treatment effects in the 50 to 60-75% range. Okay. As in the last presentation, I won't have time to talk too much about mechanisms. I'll just say that we found no evidence of discrimination by patients. That was really the purpose of the pre-consultation stage, or by the doctors. I really can't say enough about the dedication of these physicians that came in on Saturdays. We also looked at differences in their quality and effort. We did board style test exams with these doctors and found, if anything, the non-African-American doctors scored slightly higher. So it didn't seem to be an obvious quality gradient that we were picking up. What did we find evidence for? Communication. And we found evidence that the doctors were more likely to take notes on the subject. The subjects were more likely to want to talk to the doctors. And our back of the envelope health calculation is that we could reduce the cardiovascular mortality gap between black and white men by about 20% if we were able to scale this treatment. But scaling this treatment and getting more African American male doctors in medical school and into the workforce is a challenge that I think that Asha will be able to speak to much better than I can. Thank you.